think if one put into almost any imaginable public opinion survey, is it desirable to modernize through energy efficiency? It would be one question that would likely get overwhelming support across any demographic or partisan divide you can imagine in the abstract. That said, the challenge of transitioning and adjusting all of the institutional, individual, corporate, and governmental behaviors that would be necessary to truly modernize through energy efficiency is indeed a challenging one. Indeed, just think of the case of local governments in the state of Michigan. On the one hand, hearing presentations at this conference from leaders of Grand Rapids, Ann Arbor, places that have dedicated staff, resources to try to aggressively pursue this goal. And yet for other local governments in Michigan, the biggest energy issue is keeping the streetlights on 50% of the time. Or, as we do our twice a year surveys of Michigan public policy leaders, local government leaders, over 15% of our respondents cannot respond electronically because they don't have access to high-speed internet. They wouldn't even be able to watch the web stream. That's the range just within government, much less going to the corporate side, the nonprofit side, cutting across states. And so we're really fortunate to have this panel to think about this question of modernizing through energy efficiency. I'd like briefly to introduce each of the panelists and then invite them to offer their presentations in order of that you see in the program. Delighted to welcome Kevin Self from Johnson Controls, Wade Smith from the Air Movement and Control Association, Kevin Messner from PolitcaLogic, speaking on behalf of the Association of Home Appliance Manufacturers, and Anna Garcia from the U.S. Department of Energy. As before, we'll go through each of these presentations, but also try to leave sufficient time for Q&A prior to our lunch break. Kevin, would you like to lead us off?
Sure. So, also similar to other speakers earlier today, thanks to the Alliance to Save Energy and Urban Institute for putting this together. I actually spend quite a bit of time, actually in the state of California and around the world, as different geographies are trying to solve this issue, and it is clearly not an issue that is hit by any borders. It hits the entire planet, even the report that was released this morning. So I'm also a Michigan grad, and so I'm very happy to be back here, a bit saddened by last night, but I do live in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and my middle son is a freshman at the University of Wisconsin, so for the next week, we are Go Badgers. So let me give you some background on Johnson Controls. We were founded in 1885 by Warren S. Johnson, who was a professor at the University of Wisconsin, I believe now Whitewater. And one of his big issues in 1885 was this temperature in his classrooms would fluctuate dramatically from the highs to the lows to the hots and the colds. And he figured out there's got to be a better way to solve this. And so he invented the thermostat. And so 129 years later, Johnson Controls is now about a $42 billion global company, three primary businesses. One is our power solutions business, so think lead acid battery today, historically. Going forward, we're rethinking that as what are the energy storage opportunities that's necessary to even impact this conversation we're having today. We also have an automotive experience business, a lot of those individuals in this state. And so we're working on a lot of the automotive seating and other structures within your cars. The business that I'm in is the building efficiencies business, about $15 billion in global revenue. We actually are in 170 countries around the world. We're also on all seven continents, and that includes Antarctica. And so the scientific station down in Antarctica has our Metasys building systems in it. As I've told people, I doubt we can send a truck to it very quickly, but it's at least our technology. But we basically every day are walking into tens of thousands of buildings on this planet and believe that we have a huge entitlement, we have great capabilities to help fix this issue which we're talking about today. And so the belief we have is designing, optimizing, constructing, and retrofitting buildings is going to be a huge driver of the savings that we're all signing up on the panel to the left. Specifically, from a report I'd recently seen, is the expected increase in energy consumption over the next 30 years through 2040 is 56% on this planet. And in that, the big issue is that buildings in the US specifically account for 72% of the electricity produced, 55% of the natural gas used, and 40% of the total energy consumption. So unless we fix this buildings issue, we will not be able to fix this issue. And so once again, Johnson Controls, we think we have a very great set of offerings to help to do this. So that's the opportunity, the interest. Every year we run a survey through our Institute of Building Efficiency, over 3,000 global decision makers across 10 countries. The good news is the interest has increased 116% globally since 2010. 41% saying energy is an absolute critical issue that we have to deal with. However, and there's always a however, in the US, 41% of the decision makers have reduced their investment on energy efficiency because of issues such as what's going to be the future policies of this country? Can we make money at this? And until we really get that settled, it's difficult for us to make decisions to go forward. Now let me talk about the solution. We actually just today released a press release with the University of Akron that Johnson Controls, working with the University of Akron, are driving 60 million of energy savings on that campus over the next 15 years. So 4 million a year guaranteed. And it's similar to a big announcement that Johnson Controls made in December of this year with the state of Hawaii, in that we've come into an agreement with them to really manage the energy of their 17, I believe, public airports, where Johnson Controls is guaranteeing $500 million of savings over the next 19 years. And we do this through a variety of technologies and capabilities. Our history is really in the HVAC space, heating, ventilation, air conditioning. Lighting, which has been brought up before, is also a critical component. Plug load, the amount of energy used in these buildings for very minor things that we don't think about, but everyone plugging in heaters, refrigerators, you name it, there's great opportunities to drive savings on that. And another investment that we've made is into a company we bought 3 years ago called Energy Connect. So we're now working on demand response. That how can you get these buildings at the appropriate times to reduce their load, get paid more than what they would be charged regularly to help continue to drive this equation. Over our history, we've guaranteed $7.5 billion of energy savings, which we guarantee. We know we can do this. We know how to do these things. And we look forward to continuing to work a lot here in the state of Michigan, in the US and around the world to help help fix this.
Thank you. Wade.
I'm the head of the Association of Air Movement and Control Manufacturers. We have 320 members who manufacture air control and air moving products. Air moving is a fancy word for a fan. What most people don't realize is that fans in buildings like this one run continuously. And because of that, they represent about 40% of the kilowatt hours. They may only be 10% of the connected load, but they're 40% of the kilowatt hours that are consumed by commercial building HVAC systems. So commercial building HVAC represents about half of the fan industry, and industrial applications represent the other half. Altogether, of the 50 quads of energy that are used in America, fans consume about 0.75. So it, you know, it seems like a small number, 1.5%, but it's a lot of energy. There had been a huge effort over the last, 50 years to improve energy efficiency in building HVAC systems, but very little of that has been focused on fans because the connected load is low, and so the product and its efficiency has largely been overlooked. That's ending. The Department of Energy in 2011 announced their intent to engage in a rulemaking to establish minimum efficiency requirements for commercial fans. And we as an association are heavily involved in the development of those rules. And so I'm going to tell a story, right? Which is not does not have an ending, at least at this juncture, and kind of give you an update of the dilemma that we face in this effort to try and improve fan efficiency. I want to mention a couple of other things to create a benchmark for you. A fan consumes its first cost in energy every year. A fan consumes its first cost in energy. If you pay $10,000 for a fan, you've purchased a $10,000 per year liability. So a small, say a 50% increase in the price of the fan that creates a 50% drop in its energy has a very quick payback. So we're dealing here with a product, A, that consumes a lot of energy, B, that represents a lot of opportunity. So let me say another factoid. In an effort to inform the rulemaking with the Department of Energy, we created a database of every fan, every commercial fan that was sold in 2012. And that database includes the efficiency of the fan at its potential and the efficiency of the fan as it was applied. And the range of efficiency at the point of application varies from 21% to about 90%. And what you should take away from that is not that there are efficient fans and inefficient fans, but rather that there are efficient applications of fans and inefficient applications. So if we had a fan sitting on the podium today that had a 90% potential efficiency, it could be applied at 30 or 40% efficiency. So there is an opportunity to improve fan efficiency by changing the aerodynamic design of the fan wheel and the scroll that surrounds it and the inlets and the outlets of the fan. And that can get you, say, from 90% to 92%. But the significant opportunity has to do with applications. And one of our fears, and this is the dilemma that we face, is that cost-effective, by that I mean justified, improvements in the aerodynamic efficiency of a design, say that have a quick payback, will also obviously raise the price. Now, as an association representing manufacturers, I can assure you our manufacturing members have no objection to this idea. In fact, they sell wide ranges of products, many of which are very, very efficient. The problem isn't the availability of efficient fans. The problem is the willingness of the market to purchase and apply fans efficiently. And so with this quick payback, with this opportunity, with the fact that there are very efficient products on the market, the question is, why does the market not purchase the more efficient fan that has the quick payback? And there are two reasons. In a large segment of the market, the individual or the business entity that makes the purchase decision never pays the utility bill. And so the payback for their decision to buy a more efficient fan is infinite. And, you know, somebody asked earlier, what's the role of government? The role of government is to impose a requirement on that transaction that the fan meet a certain minimum efficiency. This is typically done through codes. So, you know, if you build a house, you see a 2x6 over the doorway, or 2x8 over the doorway, and you wonder, why isn't it a 2x6? The answer is because the code required the contractor to use a 2x8. And we have that similar situation in energy efficiency with fans. The other reason is that people don't have the financial capital. This is a capital expenditure. They don't have the financial capacity to buy the more efficient product. And that is a matter of linking the return on that investment to the investment itself. And I've heard a lot of talk up here about dealing with both circumstances. I think that's excellent. I think government definitely has a role. And our association and the manufacturers that I represent are certainly supportive of that effort. So that's my background.
Thank you, Wade. Kevin, please.
Thanks. I represent the Association of Home Appliance Manufacturers. We have three divisions. There's major appliance, portable appliances, and floor care. portable appliances actually make some fans as well, but a little smaller.
Yeah.
Smaller fans than the residents. What I'm going to talk about briefly today is really almost a case study of public policy. It's a reality, but it just shows the complexity of trying to deal with public policy and energy efficiency. But it's happening. What we're doing right now with the appliance industry is an early replacement appliance program. And let me step back by making sure that everybody's aware that appliances, major appliances, through standards, federal standards, have increased efficiencies. Refrigerators use 50% less energy today than they used to. Clothes washers use 70% less energy. They use much less water. And so there is a tremendous amount of energy savings that can be achieved by replacing an old, inefficient appliance with a new one. And plus, people like to get new appliances, they like to have the new features, and there are rebate programs out there today through utility programs, and these rebate programs are win-wins. The utilities are helping people buy a new appliance, the people get to save electricity, save money on their electricity bills, and then the grid is a benefit because there's less energy being used on the grid. So it's win-win all the way around. However, today we see purchase rebates and disposal rebates, and they're not marketed very well. Many people don't even know about them, and a lot of times there's all kinds of criteria. It has to be a working refrigerator, it has to be a 15-year-old refrigerator, it has to be the second refrigerator, not any refrigerator. And this creates real problems. And the case study on public policy when it comes to efficiency is, it might be easier if you had to go to Congress or maybe to one federal agency to try to get a public policy done. For energy, we're having to deal with Department of Energy, who we deal with a lot and they're great to deal with in their expert technology. We have to deal with EPA on Energy Star, and we're dealing with them on this appliance rebate program, appliance replacement rebate program. You have FERC that's kind of, sort of, not really has jurisdiction over the states. And then you have the 50 PUCs. Then you have the 3,100 plus utilities. You have the different ISOs. So let's try to get all of these people and all these entities and all these authorities moving together on the one path. It's very difficult to do. So where is the next kind of pot at the end of the rainbow for energy efficiencies? We have smart appliances that are coming on. I'm not going to talk about that, but the early replacement program. Right now, if you have a $35 rebate or a $50 rebate for $35 for disposal and $50 for purchase, that's not motivating a lot of people to get off the couch and to replace their refrigerator with a new, more energy efficient one. If you link those two together, and now you have a $50 and a $35, and now you have an $85 rebate, and you link it to the purchase of a new appliance, so you now can take a subsidy that goes to a disposal pickup, a company that picks up on a one-off for a disposal rebate of $50 to $75, you move that over. Now you're talking $100 and $150 rebate that's going to motivate somebody to actually replace the refrigerator or clothes washer and get water savings. This is where we can really make progress, but we need to have utilities to look at linking these two together. We need to have the PUCs, the public utility commissions, to lead and not have these sometimes, and I don't know about Michigan, I'm not talking about Michigan, but other public utility commissions where they have arcane requirements where the utilities will submit a rebate request and then there's really unrealistic and odd requirements for them, and then they push the rebates back saying, no, you don't pass the cost benefit test. One example is there's a refrigerator useful life has to be 10 years. Well, refrigerator useful lives are at least 14 or 15 years, and if you go to a disposal site, it averages 17 to 20 years. But the PUC, one PUC in another state, limits it to a 10-year useful life, which just destroys the cost benefit. So we need to link those two together to also reduce the amount of free riders. If folks know about free riders, part of a calculation for utility is how many free riders. If you have a purchase rebate, I'm in a store to buy a new refrigerator, I'm already in the market, I get to the cash register, oh, you got a new refrigerator, fine. Oh, you get a rebate, by the way. Oh, great, I'll take the rebate. They're a free rider, and that's part of the cost of doing rebates. If you link the purchase and the disposal together, you reduce those free riders. So now I'm at the cash register, I bought a new refrigerator, oh, you get a $50 rebate. Fine, I'll take it. Oh, you don't get it unless you have a second refrigerator. Okay, I do have a second refrigerator. What were you gonna do with that? I was gonna put it down in the basement as my beer fridge. Then you don't get the rebate. You get the rebate, $100 rebate, if you take that refrigerator and properly dispose of it. Okay, I'd really love to save the $100, $150. I'll go ahead and give up my old refrigerator. And now you don't have a free rider. And now you've taken an older refrigerator that could have gone on down on the basement or have gone into a secondary market. One thing people don't realize that over 18% of the refrigerators that get picked up by retailers go back and get refurbished and get sold on the secondary market. If we can eliminate the secondary market, increase the disposals, you get that older refrigerator from becoming the secondary refrigerator. Huge, huge numbers. So as an overall numbers, let me just throw some numbers at you that might get your attention. We did a very, very in-depth data analysis. We're looking at nationally, just for refrigerators, 50 million metric tons of carbon saved under this program with very conservative estimates in some areas. We're talking about 50,000 gigawatt hours at a cost of less than or around 2 cents per kilowatt hour for those utilities that are focused on the utility cost. So we're right in the ballpark. 2 cents a kilowatt hour is doable, right in the market for utilities. And they've already talked about decoupling on the last panel. You can throw that in as well. But you're talking 50 million metric tons. That's about 2% of the total power plant emissions that are out there in the country. So it's significant numbers. Now to the public policy angle. What we're looking at is a potential way, well, let me back up first off and remind everyone of Department of Energy had a stimulus program, $300 million for an appliance rebate program. That was a very successful program, had 1.7 million rebates, 90% were major appliances, and many of those were also refrigerators. So one of the problems with that appliance rebate program was, as always with energy issues, you had 50 different state programs. And that's just a reality of life, but we should try to get those programs as uniform as possible nationally so that national manufacturers that sell nationally and retailers that sell appliances nationally can develop marketing campaign and consumer awareness programs that will really increase the participation and knowledge. Some of you may be aware of the Cash for Clunkers program that was in that same stimulus. Well, however your views are on the Cash for Clunkers, everybody knew it was this much money if I brought in an old vehicle. And everybody knew of it across the country, and it really helped promote the awareness of that. So that's what we're trying to get. So one of the angles we're looking at on the public policy side is what's called the 111D. Section 111D, or its existing power plant rule, new power plant source, however you think about it with EPA, there's a rule out there, controversial. It's a rule that EPA is pursuing. They're going to propose it by June. We're looking at trying to encourage EPA and DOE and this administration to include, if they're going to do this rule, to include an early replacement program as a tool, as an option that utilities can use. So when they're looking at, if they come to a point where they need to find efficiencies and carbon credits, then this is one tool in their toolbox. And then we think that it'll be an effective and financial tool. So this is where you get multiple federal regulations. Congress is having a say on this. DOE could have an influence on this. The PUCs and utilities, all of this has to come together with the manufacturers, with the retailers, with the advocacy community. And we are working with everyone on that, Sarah. We've got advocates, energy efficiency and environmental advocates that support this program. So these are the kind of things where everybody needs to come together, and the numbers are big. They're big, and they really can work. And it's a win-win where you have elected officials and utilities and everyone Everybody would like to have a new appliance too, so at the end of the day, they're getting a new appliance. The appliances that they bring in their home, they trust these appliances, they love these appliances, everybody wants a new range or dishwasher, it makes their lives easier, and they now are going to save money on their electric bill. And then on the end of the day, the grid has benefited. Fewer peaker plants, fewer need to deal with things and carbon credits. So it's this win-win that goes all the way around, but it takes coordination from so many different areas to make it roll out nationally. But we're doing it. We're in Michigan. I actually did work for General Motors, like seems like everybody did in this room at one point. But as an engineer, manufacturing engineer, and sometimes they say you have to stop designing and start manufacturing. Well, the appliance industry is ready and is start manufacturing and starting this program to roll out. And we're just looking to try to increase the participation and awareness of this so everyone can join hands and start doing this. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. Anna, you can probably provide a public policy case study of your own for the Department of Energy.
Well, there's probably many to choose from. But today I want to talk a little bit. I want to also thank Kateri for the invitation to speak today and folks at the Urban Institute. We're very excited about Energy 2030, and especially Energy 2030 on the road, as you look at how to work with state and local governments help the private sector leaders pull the many levers that they have to incentivize energy efficiency and clean energy technology. We've been working with state and local governments for years. That's what I particularly do at the Weatherization Intergovernmental Program. And we have a number of different actions we're taking to modernize regulations and to look at ways to help incentivize modernization of infrastructure to improve energy productivity. So I'm going to run through a few different program areas we're working on, some that are in my program, some that are not. As we've touched on today, appliance standards, a very big, very important area that we work on. We've got standards in place for about 50 or so product categories, and in the past year we finalized another 5 efficiency rules. We've got proposals for 3 additional rules coming into place. And through these standards, we're about 2/3 of the way towards meeting the Climate Action Plan goal of saving 3 billion metric tons of carbon by 2030. We're also working in the area of building energy codes. We're looking at the progress that states and local governments have been making on building energy codes on the most recent one since 2009. We want to help and provide information that are needed to support code adoptions and to tackle some of the difficult code compliance issues that state and local partners are facing. We also have the Better Buildings Initiative, under which we've created the Better Buildings Challenge, which we launched about 2 years ago, where we're partnering with leaders who commit to set energy savings goals of 20% or more, report on those results, and showcase the solutions that get at those results. I particularly am involved in the public sector piece of that, and we're pleased to have more than 70 state, local, and education public sector partners, including states like Minnesota and Iowa, Chicago, Illinois, Cleveland, Columbia, Missouri, Pittsburgh, PA, and we also have a number of universities. Very glad to say the University of Michigan and Michigan State are participants in that as well. So these public sector partners, along with about 100 or so private sector partners and allies, have collectively made commitments of more than 3 billion square feet and are showcasing more than 50 projects and nearly 40 implementation models, demonstrating solution pathways, again, towards modernizing facilities, modernizing operations, and achieving a lot of energy efficiency savings. These partners have reported savings of about 2.5% annually on energy intensity, or a total of 58 million in 2012. We have a summit, a Better Building Summit, coming up in May, where we'll report on 2013 results, and that's happening in Washington, D.C. We're also very excited because we've expanded our Better Buildings Initiative to cover the multifamily sector in partnership with HUD, so trying to make some of those connections that make some of these programs run a little bit more easily. And we've got some accelerators to try and work with about 20 cities and utilities to look at data access issues for whole building benchmarking. We've got another 19 city, states, and school districts working on performance contracting, so trying to sign up about $2 billion in contracts along the lines of what you were talking about with the state of Hawaii, and to try and streamline and improve that mechanism. There's a sort of a bad rap some performance contracting has gotten in the state and local sector, and we're really trying to demystify those stories and make it work a little more consistently across government. And then we've also established, as part of Better Buildings, a solution center as part of our neighborhood program. That was funded chiefly under the Recovery Act, and they tested multiple sustainable program strategies in over 40 communities and also logged more than 100,000 energy efficiency upgrades. So those models are part of that solution center that state and local governments can take advantage of. I think some of you may be familiar with the State and Local Energy Efficiency Action Network, or SEACTION. It's specifically mentioned in the recommendations for Energy 2030. A network of 200 or more state and local policymakers leading the way towards addressing issues that are necessary for taking efficiency to scale. Again, jointly facilitated between DOE and EPA. So they're looking at best practices and recommended approaches in a whole host of areas, and have come out with resources, including a guide on energy audits and retrocommissioning, giving state and local policy design guide and sample policy language, financing program implementation primer, and very soon we'll have a guide on designing effective state programs for the industrial sector, focusing on industrial energy efficiency. So again, a number of different pathways that, these groups have been talking about and working on to help really scale up our investment. Two other long-standing programs, ones that I'm particularly involved in at DOE, are the State Energy Program and the Weatherization Assistance Program. And we're revamping Post-Recovery Act to try and help our state and local partners continue to be able to modernize. Over the last 2 years, the State Energy Program has really been targeted in focusing its portfolio of competitively awarded projects. We're working with 40-plus states on overcoming barriers to industrial energy efficiency and combined heat and power, setting or enhancing energy efficiency resource standards, and lead by example, and also looking at different performance contracting models and ways to do energy efficiency and economic roadmap development. I think one thing I want to mention, just sort of in the area of new work that's going on, we have two new areas coming out in our FY14 competitive funding opportunity announcement. One focuses on state energy planning, so really looking at how to leverage energy efficiency, environmental regulation and requirements, and economic opportunity in terms of making an energy efficiency plan with state governments. And then the second topic will allow states to work on competitive projects over a broad set of state and utility-based policies and programs. In the 15 budget, if you had a chance to take a look at that, you'll see a $200 million request for one-time funding for Race to the Top performance-based awards. Again, very much in line with the 2030 energy program. We've got $227 million requested to keep the weatherization assistance program going and to help them work on worker and work performance certification standards across the country, which will really help the residential retrofit market grow, we believe. And then the state energy program, we also have an increase there to try and foster more competitive initiatives and a greater level of technical assistance. One other key program I want to mention is a new request for $4 million to fund a local technical assistance program. And again, in the wake of the significant energy efficiency conservation block grant ending, this is a way that we can continue to make headway with our local partners and continue that momentum. So I just wanted to outline for you a few ways that we're trying to work collaboratively with state and local governments that align with the Energy 2030 goals as we look at the many challenges our partners face. I'm looking to work in different areas, including capacity and infrastructure. There's certainly a need to develop that. It's very important at the local level, particularly. Those investments that were made under the Block Grant Program allowed for a lot of energy champions to be put in place in local communities, but with that funding waning at this time as we close out those awards, the question is, who will be leading the charge at the local government level on energy efficiency? And we certainly at DOE want to help. Another really very key issue is leveraging public sector funding, which is limited, 100 or 1,000-fold with private financing and private investment, and looking at ways that we can work with everyone in this room and across the country to help think through how to amplify those limited dollars. And then another key issue that we really want to focus on is scaling up demand, which I think is critical across the country to really get these technologies to be recognized for their energy and environmental benefits and utilized greatly. And I was talking last night to a gentleman who has shared with me a model that's going on in the residential retrofit industry, which I just thought was so intriguing because it's one of the hardest nuts to crack as we work towards trying to build energy efficiency out in the country. So again, just wanted to touch on a few areas, and I look forward to the discussion today and suggestions from you all about other ways DOE can look forward to taking action with you to crack some of the walls for these barriers and make progress on energy efficiency. So thank you.
Thanks to all of you. Want to invite people to begin to come down and use the microphones? Please.
Thank you, Barry. Greg White again, Commissioner with the Michigan Public Service Commission. Another excellent panel. You touched on, you know, a wide array of things that are going on both within your industries and with the Department of Energy. And I co-chaired one of the C-Action work groups for 2 years, so I'm quite familiar with that and certainly believe that's an outstanding program. But as I did with the earlier panel, I'm going to kind of break it down into real simple. We heard an interesting survey this morning from the U of M Energy Institute, and I had heard this previously. I haven't yet seen it, and I look forward to reading about it. But the suggestion that we could increase energy costs, I believe what it said, by 170% before it becomes unaffordable, is a concept doesn't fit necessarily well with our jobs at the Public Service Commission. I can tell you, if I approve a rate increase of even 2%, the hate mail comes in pretty hot and heavy. So I wanted to, I guess, throw out a question on affordability. From the building trades, from the efficiency programs, how do we address the issue of energy affordability, particularly as we look at modernizing our system, and you know, we look at modernization not just from the end user, but also we look at efficiency and modernization of the grid, which goes back to my earlier comment about the infrastructure investments and what keeps me up at night. But you've had some good suggestions, some good ideas, but I wanted to throw it out, I guess, even more simply. How do we address that concept of affordability for energy investments?
Yeah, I'm happy to start. There's two areas. I didn't talk about smart appliances much, but one area out there, and I'm not sure what the real-time pricing situation is in Michigan, but if you had real-time pricing and smart appliances, let me just give you one example of how the consumer could save. This isn't getting to a rate increase, but this is how a consumer would be able to save money under the current rates and then make policy decisions from there. A refrigerator uses on average now today less than 50 watts, so it's less than a 50-watt light bulb. If we did another standard change, we just negotiated a standard change with the advocates that DOE's implemented, it'll come effective in September to prevent a patchwork of 50 state standards. So we have one national standard for the refrigerator, come due in September, which is another about 25% increase in efficiency. You just, for simple math, 50 watts, if you take 10% increase in efficiency, that's 5 watts. A smart refrigerator, as designated by the Energy Star program, will move the defrost, which is 300-400 watts, which generally the defrost heater will turn on maybe generally during dinner time and peak with all the door openings. It'll automatically shift that to the middle of the night. So if you had real-time pricing, the consumer could buy a smart appliance, and they would save money if they had real-time pricing because that defrost heater would run at night when the price was low. They wouldn't have to change any behavior. No one cares when the defrost heater is running, but yet they would see a reduction with real-time pricing with smart appliances. Same situation, come up with other scenarios with other appliances. On the replacement program, you replace that old refrigerator with a new one, so their overall bill would come down. So those rebates drive consumers, their electricity savings. I actually have the number for our program. Nationally, for consumer assuming 12 cents a kilowatt hour, sounds like Michigan may not, I don't know what theirs are, consumer savings are $5 to $10 billion just on an early replacement. That's just refrigerators. So there's a lot can be had to save the consumer money on the electric bill, which then may give you the flexibility to deal with other things that you may want to do to net those out with maybe some other investments in other areas. I don't know. Others may have other thoughts.
Other folks?
I would just say, you know, part of the challenge here is the upfront cost, and which is part of what your comments address. And, you know, looking at ways to make that upfront cost more manageable over a period of time through on-bill repayment, on-bill financing, also offering, continuing to offer incentives until the price of the technologies can come down to understand the affordability of the more efficient pathway, I think would be very important and that we are working on. And of course, our R&D programs are working to reduce the cost of the technologies overall so that they can just be competitive with the current energy efficiency, with current energy technologies that are out there. You know, dollar watt solar, bringing down the cost of all of the different envelope materials so that doing a residential retrofit is very affordable upfront, and looking at other ways to improve the kinds of technologies that go into industrial facilities and buildings.
Please.
Of course, I love on-the-bill financing, because if the amortization of the investment is $10 a bill, but the savings is $12 per billing period, what's not to like? So it's a scheme by which the monthly cost drops, and it links the investment and the return on the same invoice. And whether that's done on a tax bill or it's done on a utility bill, you know, if it's a public service commission and you want to know how to deal with a rate increase, if you provide on-the-bill financing that would offset that rate increase, I think that's a very, very positive step.
And just lastly, I think there's a huge education component, which I know is one of the great edicts of this group, and some of the data Mark showed earlier about there's not a complete comprehension of this energy issue and the impact that each of us can have, and specifically with the buildings that we deal with. It's interesting at times what type of owner the building has really drives the willingness to invest, even with some of these fast turnarounds. I think the other thing, though, is the number of stakeholders necessary with a single building, much less a campus, to really say we're going to go forward with this, you know, full throttle and deliver it, and all heads agree, is not an easy task. We've had some success, and we've identified those. There's more in the pipeline, but I think it's something that's going to grow, and I think what will happen as well is as more, you know, when just a couple happen, they're rarities, they're examples. When you start seeing more of these pick up, you see individuals say, well, gosh, it does seem to be a trend, or there's a change that's occurring, and how do you jump onto this? And we do believe in the coming years, you will be seeing a lot more of this focus to drive these costs out.
Thank you. I'd like to remind anyone who would like to ask a question to just get in queue, but I'm pleased now to call upon Andy.
Andy Hoffman at the Urb Institute. Can I ask you guys to just sort of push the boundary on what's possible in the area of information technology? It seems to me that this technology is starting to emerge. We have Nest thermostats that learn our behavior. We have smart meters that can connect the house to the grid. Appliances are available, although not fully scalable yet in terms of appliances to talk to the grid. We have smart cars, smart roads. If you were to project out 10 and then maybe 25 years, blow our minds a bit. What can information technology do for us to help us achieve these kinds of goals?
I'll go first on that. So as I said, I actually spend a lot of time out in Silicon Valley sort of identifying and looking at what are these emerging opportunities, technologies, and themes that are emerging, and at least from the built environment landscape, a lot of the individuals trying to solve this do not come from the construction industry. The construction industry is one that has not changed much over the last 50 to 80 years. And so you're having these new individuals who've had success other places trying to solve this problem, and you know, no successes yet, but there's probably 75 plus companies that we are intimately tracking and working with to understand which of these experiments might make sense. In terms of 25 years from now, my belief is the way that this building will be controlled will be all of us walking in here with these devices. Mm-hmm. And these devices have been pre-programmed to what our individual likenesses are, and it takes some type of a weighted average, and that's what's affecting the HVAC and the lighting. And when all of these devices leave this room in 2 hours, temperature settles back down, lights go off, and this tracks you as you go through. Yeah, there's privacy issues and so on, but I do believe that that's an opportunity, and there's people starting to play with those type of experiments.
And I would add that there's been some discussion up here on the stage about monitoring and diagnostic monitoring, monitoring of performance and monitoring of performance in a reliability sense and in an energy sense. You know, the challenge of monitoring systems is communication. There's a microprocessor on every piece of machinery that goes into a building which knows an awful lot about what that machinery is doing, but it doesn't necessarily have the ability to communicate that. And so as communication infrastructure builds out without wires, you know, so wirelessly, then the things like you talked about where the building can be responsive to the needs of the individuals that are inside the room, you know, those are become practical technologies as opposed to, you know, fantasy. And as wireless technology comes down in cost and as it gets incorporated into the building infrastructures, more and more of that is going to happen. And there was a discussion this morning about diagnostics where, you know, you're sending a message that says, hey, look, your motor's running hot. This technology exists today. It's just it's not widely employed because the cost to employ it has been high. The cost to employ it today is much less, and certainly if you look forward, it becomes less and less. So people are going to know what's going wrong in almost in real time. So if the faucet is dripping or the toilet is running or the motor's running hot, you know, knowing about that, or the filters are dirty or the fan is not performing as it should, people are going to know that in real time. And I think that's a huge opportunity moving forward. And it's also, there's a certain inevitability to it. It can't not happen. It's going to happen.
I'll just real quickly, I don't know if this will blow your mind or not, but the appliances that are already out there for smart appliances, and we'll see what it takes off, but these are just real everyday things that'll help people. A couple of quick examples. One, they talked about sensors on the last panel. There's already appliances out there and have been out there that have diagnostics part of that and then gone online and things. So that's been out there. We'll see if people purchase those. But simple things, we have a smart clothes washer. You can look up and you can see appliance by appliance. We don't need smart meters. Smart meters can work. You could work it through cell phones, however. But you can see, oh, my clothes washer's using this much energy. My refrigerator's using this much. Here's how I could change it. If you had real-time pricing, I could run it a different time of day. Simple things, if I got potentially get a notification when my clothes washer's done. I don't know how many times, at least you go down to the basement. Oh, it's not quite done yet. It'll come back up. Tell you on the cell phone, boom, you got an alert when it's done. Or that the refrigerator door is open. Somebody left the refrigerator door open. It's on your cell phone or somewhere on an energy management. Those little things that really will help. The kitchen is where all these appliances are a central part of the home, and these appliances are a central part of people's lives in the home. And these kind of things you will see and are seeing. And Energy Star has established a smart category for refrigerators, and then we're looking at for clothes washers and clothes dryers, so it'll incentivize manufacturers to do more. Now we'll have to see what kind of future it holds with the people that decide to buy them.
So for my part, what I see, I've talked a little bit about the data access part of the accelerator that we're working on with cities and utilities, and so much of the energy stream data is aggregated, and being able to disaggregate it quickly and talk to state and local policymakers about what they can do in their own buildings, or commercial sector folks, what they can do in their buildings, for them to be able to see that impact on their building basis is very important. Also, I would say as we move to towards this, you know, connection between, that we continue to try to make between energy efficiency, environment, and economic opportunity. The more diagnostic information you have about what your, how your energy efficiency action results in savings and environmental benefits directly to you, state and local policymakers can use that to incentivize greater efficiency for the public good in that domain. So we want to try and look at how to disaggregate information in ways that can readily avail folks of what they need for decision making and for financing. That is also key. So much more granular information provided very quickly by the technologies is what we're looking at.
So a bit of a glimpse into the future. Thank you. Please.
Hi, Brian Rassel with the Herb Institute. So in the past few years, we've obviously seen this great natural gas boom, and it's really changed the economics and the importance of, well, certainly renewables, but also possibly taken a little bit the wind out of the sails of energy efficiency measures. So with that in mind, how are you guys making the case that all of this stuff is preeminent and important economically for job creation, et cetera, in the face of others who might like to see dollars, programs, incentives geared towards this more traditional source of energy?
Well, I think, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I think we have a lot of public support for energy efficiency and renewable energy, and we're not maximizing it to the extent that we can. Through information, through efforts like Energy 2030, through grassroots education efforts. I know, you know, it is a very difficult question with the abundant supply of natural gas that appears to be coming online. But we're not exactly sure what direction that is going to take in terms of what will be utilized in this country, what will be, you know, utilized as exports. And I think we just really have to keep our eyes focused on how we want to become an overall leader with an all-of-the-above energy strategy where energy efficiency and renewables are still a very important component.
You know, just for renewables, respect smart appliances and getting these smart appliances on the grid as well with renewables, the intermittent nature of renewables with wind and solar, smart appliances can feed right into that, where a couple examples, you could have a dryer's running, the heater element's on, the wind, and you're running off of wind or solar, the cloud comes or the wind stops, that heater element could turn off for 10 minutes or less spinning reserve, and most people aren't going to notice it. It still has heat capacity within the dryer, it's still going to tumble, it's still going to go, and then the heater element will turn back on. But that will allow the economics of a wind farm or a solar to actually come out. Another thing is a dishwasher. Some people may have a dishwasher where you go to bed at night, you hit, I'm going to delay start for 2, 3, 4 hours. How about a button where it goes when it turns on in the middle of the night when the wind's blowing? And that'll help incentivize renewables. So these new appliances really fit into the ability for these, whatever, natural gas, electricity, renewables, they can do it all.
Implicit in the question is that a reduction of the cost of energy will undermine the payback of investments in energy efficiency. And that's true. But I think the bigger barrier to investments in energy efficiency have nothing to do with the payback. They have to do with the fact that in many cases, the people making the decision, if you're an apartment owner and you're developing an apartment building, you're buying appliances, but you'll never pay the utility bill. So what appliance is the right appliance for you? It's the least efficient, least costly appliance. And the cost of energy has no impact on your decision because your incentive is clear. In the other segment where the ratepayer and the investor is the same entity, it's the availability of capital that constrains the investment, not the payback. There's almost an overwhelming opportunity for energy efficiency investments that are not being made. And if we focus our attention on why and resolving, dealing with the reasons why people don't invest in energy efficiency, there's a lot of opportunity. And that would be true even if natural gas prices were half of their current level.
I'd like to offer a final question. Andy asked about pushing the envelope of technology. We push the envelope of public policy for a moment. It strikes me that in each of your opening comments, there were public policy aspects that are quite intriguing to think about. And Kevin, you talked about moving to as uniform a system as possible and raised this very interesting question of going back to Section 118D of the Clean Air Act, classic command and control, and somehow retrofitting that to allow uniformity, but then allowing some degree of flexibility. How do all of you see the what we might call the federalism issue, where obviously there's this desire for some uniformity, consistency, but presumably we would not want to lose opportunities for places like Johnson Control to negotiate with the state of Hawaii and design something really unique to that state. How do you see the policy aspects of this moving forward in creative ways, or the political aspects of unifying all of these forces that normally don't get together and can collaborate?
In my area, I think one of the key issues regarding consistency is on measurement and verification. I mean, that is just the underpinning of all that we do. And no matter what the design of the program, if the measurement of energy efficiency, if the unit is recognized as the same, then you've got a level playing field no matter what you're doing on the public policy front to actually move the ball forward. So I think, you know, we're really looking at some uniform methodology, some uniform standards, some uniform set of data points that you need for these technologies and for the programs that incentivize them to use.
Yeah, it's always a good question, because a couple examples. One is standards. We have a federal appliance standards, and appliance industry, a lot of times the regulations, when there's regulations, they're burdensome and they're costly and they're not always done real well. But for appliance standards, and President Reagan actually signed the bill into law, there was this grand compromise where we were seeing a patchwork of 50 regulations and standards instead of one uniform standard. So if you're for less regulation, one federal regulation is less regulation than 50 state regulations that are disparate. And we're seeing the same thing play out now on green chemistry or TSCA reform or green chemistry, where there is attempts by some to get a federal uniform program on that, but you have states fighting it for states' rights. Energy, it's the same thing. They tried to put real-time pricing in the last energy bill, and they said states should really try hard to do real-time pricing. How much impact did that have? I think pretty much none. And so I think the hurdle politically in D.C. and with the states, because you have each state weighing in with their senators and congressmen, depending on which side they are, really makes it difficult to create a federal uniformity in a lot of ways. And in the utility area, and that's just not happening, so we just have to deal with what we have and try to get as much cooperation through regional programs as possible.
We're near time, but if you have a quick comment, go right ahead.
Well, to scale and to deliver efficiency cost effectively, it's helpful to have one standard rather than trying to design different products for different localities. And I think manufacturers, at least in my experience, favor, you know, federal minimum efficiency requirements.
Okay. Mr. Chairman?
Okay. Please join me in thanking this panel.